know, we're going to have to start. We can't use Angavata time today because we have very limited time in the room, and one of our panelists needs to rush off to the airport. So, I also, when we planned this event, I had no idea that it would be a very small, informal event. 2 years ago, some of you may remember, we were in a very large room with all kinds of officials from the Austrian Culture Ministry and embassies, consulates, etc. Lots of formal thanks and introductions, etc. We're going to cut to the chase today. We want to get as many ideas as possible out as quickly as possible. But we'll do very short introductions. I'll let you know who our panelists are. everybody's got name tags. Charlie Haley wrote a marvelous, in some ways, game-changing book called Camps, 4 or 5 years ago? More than 4 or 5 years ago. Teaches at University of Florida in Gainesville. Next to him is Rachel Silvey, the one real geographer we have on today's panel from the University of Toronto. Eyal Weitzman from Goldsmiths College in London and plenty of other places. I think he likes to say that he is a forensic architect. I don't know if he still says that, but yeah, is that what we are? Forensic architect. Everybody Google that word before we begin. Pierre Bélanger from the GSD may or may not turn up. And finally, Gerald Bast, your friendly and esteemed rector from the Angavante. And I guess with that, we will begin. I will take a couple of minutes to rhetorically frame today's conversation, which you may know is called the Age of Geography, which I suppose if some of you are trying to figure out what that might mean, think about it as it's no longer the age of geometry. That's for the architects. Okay. So don't think my little text made a lot of sense to anybody. It's meant as provocation, and I'm hoping that that's what we'll get from the panelists today. The day is when a clever, attractive, and humane housing schema could serve as a credible response to every problem of social design belongs to an innocent world in which city and state are still conceived as mirror processes that take place at merely different scales. But just as the theory of plate tectonics in the 1960s introduced an inescapable dynamism and insecurity into our understanding of the geology on which we fashion our fragile civilizations, so our understanding of the multiform and independent economies and behaviors of cities has separated them radically from the more stable, unitary, but archaic aspirations of states. It's a very long sentence. I'm famous for my long sentences. Can't do much about it. And what it really means is that city and state actually have very different operations. Cities are calamitous in their spontaneity. They embrace history just as fervently as states resist it. Cities seek their own equilibria by feeding and by feeding off of flows, just as states shore up their illusory sovereignties with antiquated images and notions of unchanging character, like blood and soil and Dasein. Cities are dynamos of innovation, agents of the modern, of the rootless and the new. And they have always harbored an essential antipathy to the states that encompass them. It may well be that this antipathy is reaching a tipping point as global integration migration and regional flows, not only of resources, but populations and intellectual capital in the form of doctrines and beliefs, begin to challenge the firmness and permanence of nations and their ideas. All design is social design, one could say. Insofar as every proposition introduces a disturbance into the world, that the world must in turn accommodate by changing itself. It must restore equilibrium or else pass the disturbance along to another level. And in so doing, modifies the habitat in which all creatures, us included, make their living. The importunate nature, the inescapability of this chain of flow is today becoming the dominant material condition of our historical existence. Can architects, or shall I say for the moment, design workers or design intellectuals ignore this axiomatic fact? Can they opt out, as they often have, and claim disciplinary protection or immunity as mere geometers of rooms, unconcerned by the radically changing patterns of movement of matter and energy over the surface of the earth? Clearly, my provocation suggests, for at least for today, no. The so-called infrastructural revolution of the last 20 years has shown architects at their cosmopolitan best as they engaged a whole new scale of action and thought beyond the building and different from it. A near wholesale reconception of the environment as a technical apparatus. Abstract rationality and concrete material all at once. It's kind of a different way of thinking that we started to get used to in the 1990s. This gave way in its wake to a long overdue reinvestment in urbanist thought and practice, and the integration of landscape and even wilderness ecology into urbanist and architectural thought and curriculums. Even the concept of territory, a geopolitical abstraction, began to appear in design discourse. Today we stand on this new ground as we confront the new pressures of war, of putative clashes of civilization, resource colonization, religious crusades, scarcity, and preeminently climate shift that for the first time in the modern era are setting into motion not only new flows of matter and capital, but massive displacements of populations as well. The preliminary swells of these population movements have already triggered a near breakdown of the first world political and economic order. One inevitable hypothesis is that borders themselves, containers of regional and national identities as guarantors of security, are already effectively dissolved, leaving a massive vacuum of effective institutions and even ideas to replace them. The invention of new institutions may well be a specifically political problem, but the onus for new ideas, for new ways for our cities to respond to and to integrate the new living maps that are emerging is one tailored for the 21st century design imagination. So I will now turn over the discussion to the panelists. I think we'll start with Gil, feeling properly introduced by this, to weigh in with some of the ways in which designers and thinkers and pedagogues are coming to terms with what one might call the age of geography.
Thank you, Sanford. Thank you, Mr. distinguished panelists for coming. I'm really happy and proud that the University of Applied Arts every year has the opportunity to have this kind of situation here at the Biennale, Guild of the Arts for Architecture. Well, it's all about civilization, what we are talking about all the time. And Sanford, you mentioned migration for several reasons. Actually, the history of civilization is a history of migration. It's only some 2,000 generations in the back when our forefathers and foremothers migrated from Africa to Europe, to Asia, to Australia, and so on. It's not so far back. And actually, we are here in Venice, and Venice is a city founded, established by refugees in a situation which we can read right now in several magazines or articles, which is not too different from what we have now, the period of the European migration between the 5th and the 7th century. So this is a city founded by migrants, by refugees who fled from a situation which was for them in terms of security but also in terms of economy not bearable. And they fled to these kind of islands and founded the city of Venice. And the first Doge was elected or appointed by the citizens in the seventh century. So, what I want to say and what we hear now is that all these crises. So we still hear the word crisis. The whole world is a world of crisis: the economic crisis and the refugee crisis. And the crisis of population and migration. So we are just stuck in all kinds of crises. But if we look with a kind of calm blood to what is happening and not just being excited of what is happening right now, yesterday or maybe tomorrow, we should accept that what is happening now should not be just seen or discussed under the term of catastrophe. As we could see from the picture of Venice, it's not a catastrophe what we are facing here in Venice now. So it is, of course, a situation, a period of massive changes. And a lot of people around us, and probably we and our children will have major problems in the next years and decades because of these changes. But it's, and this is what I'm speaking now as head of a university, it's our duty, it's our mission, it's our responsibility not to be stuck into depression and looking only at these kind of situations from the mirror of catastrophe and all kinds of bad things. We should have kind of optimism. We should kind of have again, and I really say again, try to bring up some kind of visionary optimism. Also, and I say this being at the Architecture Biennale, in terms of the built culture architecture. We just heard in these days the Austrian Pavilion named Places for People. at the World Exhibition of Architecture. And what is it about? It's about places for people in buildings, kind of rotten buildings, which are not anymore usable as offices, and now being used for migrants, refugees. We just heard 2 hours ago the Spanish Pavilion became the winner, got the Golden Lion. The Spanish Pavilion, in my opinion, a wonderful pavilion, what they made, but it's about unfinished, left buildings. Buildings with no original continuous use, appropriated, changed use in some ways. So is this the future? Is this the vision of built culture? Is this the vision of architecture for, and I say this consciously, for 90 or even for the 99% of our population? We often talk about history, art history of architecture, and of course, if we look at the history of architecture, it is mainly a history of built culture for religion, for economic power, for political powers. Where is architecture building iconic culture for the 99%? Is it really the visionary thing that if we talk about the 90 or 99% that we just talk about reuse or ephemeral architecture for people who cannot afford iconic architecture? These are the things we should talk about. These are the things, in my opinion, we also should think about, especially at university. Thank you.
Thank you. Ayal, can I ask you maybe one of the
by presenting forensic architecture, and I took my short proposition to speak from it, and really on what we could learn from conflict analysis, from human rights analysis, to the questions of architecture today. And in particular, I'd like to organize this short comment around the proposition of the collateral, and to propose the collateral as a category that stands, that is structural to architecture. So to say, architecture stands as an interface between the design and the collateral. Collateral is the kind of unintended consequence. So we in the human rights community would say, would confront militaries that say, well, we're bombing Taliban, let's say, somewhere, and those civilians died as a collateral consequences of this intention. It was not our intention to kill civilians. I think that in discussing architecture itself as a profession, we're very much attached to the design element to it, and much less so to the so-called collateral. Right? What does it do economically? What does it do to the environment? What does it do to workers' rights? What does it do to the city, etc.? But in particular, in placing architecture between design and collateral, understanding the kind of predictable and unpredictable consequences, right? Entering unpredictability, or to a certain extent, when you take the military category of the collateral, predictable unpredictability, right? We know that civilians are going to die. The sense of saying we do not know is a certain legal protection. So architecture is an interface in the machine of modulating and filtering between those categories, design and the collateral. There's so much to say about that, But I'd like to take this argument perhaps one step forward and to propose that in our discussion about the environment and about climate change, we might fall into the very same error that human rights analysis has fallen by accepting the category of the collateral. So even the most progressive writers, the most militant activists that discuss issues of climate change now worldwide, still somehow in their argument all agree that nobody wants the world to warm up. That is, that climate change is a collateral damage of history. History as a pursuit of progress. History is the increased circulation of people and capital across the surface of the earth results in the CO2 emissions, and shit happens. Nobody wanted to. Now, you know, I spent a lot of time in kind of reading colonial geographies and thinking about the world from the colonial perspective. And in fact, if you go back to 18th century discussions about climate change, in fact, the origins of the term climate change comes in debates between various European colonial administrators and agronomists and physiologists and botanists. And it emerges, it enters into the human vocabulary as a project. The culmination of colonialism is not only taking control of land, making it productive, designing the surface of the earth, making the surface of the earth, or in fact the planet, taking it as a design object. But as any architect knows, it's not enough to put walls and floors and staircases. You need air conditioning. You need to create the kind of environment that would make you comfortable or that would make you economically productive. And you could see those debates occurring along environmental thresholds. Primarily the threshold of the forest, which is a kind of equator, a political equator that runs across the earth twice. Of course, that's the edge between the kind of the fields, the cultivated fields, and the beginning of the forest, which is outside the city, if you like, or the kind of the design surface of the earth. And along another environmental threshold, and that's the threshold of the desert. When does the desert begin, and where does it begin? How do we calculate it, and how we affect it? So on the one hand, we need to identify this line. On the other hand, climate change is mobilizing in order to expand the productive capacities of the earth, right? In order to bring them into the law and into economy. Law would end at the desert, state would end at the desert, all states. Did not govern until a very late colonial period in the desert, nor in so-called jungles, right? So you could see along those two environmental thresholds processes of design that see mobilizes climate change on behalf of the economy. So now when I hear the kind of short-sighted idea that climate change is merely collateral damage, I say, no, climate change is a project. Climate change is in fact the kind of the telos of human inhabitation of the earth. Take over, redesign, change the climate. Now, it started happening in the wrong way, right? We lose control. So there is, again, a kind of the filtering between design and the collateral, between the predictable, the computable, and the incomputable, between the random and the straight line is here predictable. Now, we are, it's kind of what is managed. So I want to look at those environmental thresholds as places that have their own history. I want to look at the threshold of the desert as something whose movement propels people now across the surface of the earth, several hundred kilometers in the Sahel, in which the desert, the Sahara, moved south all along the kind of Sahel part of Central Africa. A line that would continue into Yemen and Somalia, on the other hand, the Northern African conflict shoreline, if you like, that goes later through Palestine, through Syria and Iraq, and would end up in Pakistan, Afghanistan, those micro movements that are no longer cyclical, but that move in one direction because of climate change, bring a whole lot of conflict along it. So you would see in our space, here in this building at the center, lower space, you'd see an analysis of drone strike that we've done for the UN Special Rapporteur. It's something that was presented in the General Assembly in October 2013. Having collected all drone strikes, the location of drone strikes, and put them on meteorological map, right? Let's measure drone strike versus rain. You could see that all drone strikes right now in the world take place in areas that have become under 200 millimeter rain per annum. So the obvious conclusion that I draw from it is that drone strikes are an attempt to stop desertification. Thank you very much.
By the lakes, it's the beautiful Swedish mountain area. which no one wants to be in the winter, so the refugees are permitted to be there. So I think we need to have new geographic imaginaries that aren't just about moving people in and out of places. And at the heart of this, for feminist theorists, is the question of embodiment. And thinking about which bodies inhabit which places, in what ways, and what kind of knowledge comes from embodiment. Not using the same old God trick of looking from outside in, but in fact trying to think from. In Donna Haraway's memorable phrase, strong objectivity, which involves positionality and embodiment. Thanks. So I didn't mean to start out like with a bad attitude, because I'm so thrilled to be here and to be talking to architects, but as a feminist geographer, it's so interesting to see all these models and these conversations about climate change and about design without a whole lot of talk about politics the way that critical feminist geographers would think about space. And the way we think about space isn't from the outside in. It's very much from the everyday and the embodied. And so we see cities and states as built in the bodies.
Thanks, Gerald Sanford and the rest of the panelists. I'm looking forward to the conversation and the conversation with the rest of you guys as well. I'm going to talk for just a minute through the frame of camps, because that's been a focus for me for quite a while. There's sort of two speculations that I'd like to make. One is, look, I'm interested in the relationship between camp and the contemporary, and the other, I want to zoom in really quickly on a very particular camp that's part of some current research. So for the first speculation, there's two keys to camps, and I'm taking a broad perspective of camps, everything from autonomy to necessity to control, so the entire range in these two keys, and my hope is that they might relate to this idea of the new geographical imperative that Sanford proposed. So the two premises, I think I'll call them premises, are camps accommodate conditions that might otherwise remain without space. And the second is that camps indicate change at its earliest stages. So camps as a contemporary environment make present a whole range of things. Future trajectories of migration, they trace invisible flows of capital, and they make room for aspirations of shifting demographics, as well as, again, a whole range of other flows that Sanford mentioned earlier. Along these lines, I've been thinking a lot about camps as kerotic spaces, and this is the Greek term keros, which is the figure of the opportune moment, or of grasping opportunity, or even luck, or even accident at the moment that it occurs. So here, keros is a contracted and abridged time, and it's set within chronological time. And actually, Agamben talks about it as sort of nested, chronos and kairos nested together. So it might be a moment of vision, or it might be an accident or displacement. Keros and kerotic spaces are a part of, again, what Agamben talks about when he discusses the contemporary, which he describes as a singular relation with one's own time. So at one moment it adheres to it, and at another moment it keeps its distance from it. And it works in that way. It works through disjunction and anachronism. And it's unpredictable. There's a really interesting relation between the predictable and unpredictable in that sense. So I would argue there's also an important relation between the practical and the fleeting at this moment. So to give a specific situation, I've been thinking a lot about the environment and the formal and informal economies of refugee camps, particularly Dadaab refugee camp, and the range between, just to try to be as specific as possible, the mobile money's virtual presence, the M-Pesa, in the informal economy of the DAB, and Firewood's tangible absence. And also in particular, the relationship, we might say, of the territories of the cloud and of the desert. And as you know, and it's actually those who gather firewood at the DAB are predominantly women who go out into the desert, as many as 13 kilometers round trip to gather firewood for traditional methods of cooking. So that's one vein. Another starts from a specific place, Slab City. And just to give, maybe some of y'all are familiar with this site, it's in Southern California. It's lodged within a Section 36 territory, which was in the Jeffersonian grid. It was the space that was allocated for public use. And stretching back in time, it has been an Indian camp. This is before colonial occupation. In more recent time, it was a military camp. And in really since the 1950s, it's been occupied by a whole range of people, from migrant farm workers to Canadian snowbirds, the tourists who come down escaping the cold weather, and a whole range of other occupants, like homeless people, counterculture, people who sort of move around the country through digi-hitch and other methods. My interest in Slab City began with looking at sites, occupying sites that were not originally meant for long-term occupation, nor for self-sustained or self-regulated communities. So one of the things that I'm studying in this site is the relationship between adaptation and control. And I'm hoping to understand the relation of resistance to landscape, to the desert, to codes, to the military legacy there, and even to the Corps of Engineers landworks, the system of canals. And that leads me to another relation, is between the nature of control and the control of nature, which is something that in this particular site, I mean, there's other really, a lot of other opportunities to study that elsewhere, but in this particular site, it's for me very tangible because of not only the desert environment, but also the canal system. And just a few other quick points. One of the things about that site is it's previously been studied with a focus on how it allows for freedom. It allows for choice. When actually, my argument is that its significance lies more in its response and its resistance to controlling factors. So it's a free space that at a certain point it might be unconditional, but it actually has a lot of conditions. And I think that resonates a little bit with Gary Dawes' hospitality and some of the thoughts that Zizek has written about the refugee and other situations. And so I think this leads toward a speculation that geographical knowledge emerges from contingency and particularity. And zooming further in, this is really a lived geography with material circumstances. When you go to Slab City, you're walking on what's called superstition soil. And this is sand that's been washed down from the mountains. And it's the reason that Slab City exists there, because it is unproductive land. If it were just on the other side of the historic shoreline, it would be a part of Imperial Valley's extensive irrigation system. And that's based on an alluvial soil. So just that shift. One other thing that's completely striking when you go there is the uncanny resonance of walking on the superstition sand. It's crunchy. It really introduces you when you enter into this space. And it also is an acoustic space that allows, really permits a kind of understanding of where people are and when they're there. So it really is a part of this quite uncanny and sublime space. So I'll leave it.
Introduce Reiner as well, who will somehow be part of the conversation. First, let me ask the panelists. Checking my watch. Any particular urgent wish to address one another?
Let's say the non
non-segregative mosaic of cultures. In that film, I'm sure you've seen the film, right? It's a kind of an ideal. It's a kind of romantic. Which, you know, it doesn't figure today in our highly bureaucratized, say, Kleinbürgerlich vision of what civic life is all about. Everybody gets their own, everybody is free not to be disturbed by the practice of alternate cultures, even smells of cooking bother people in many, many cultures, or at least they permit themselves to be irritated by something as, shall we say, embodied as that. So, you know, the question is what does a human have a right to claim as part of their rights as citizens? And what things should we teach ourselves or cultivate out of our general understanding of what it means to be a human being in a world of 6 or perhaps eventually 8 billion people, set into motion by massive, let's say, disturbances that are going to be coming in. This is an extraordinary problem, because what you describe as the 1%, that's only in 2015 and 2016. The percentages are going to be far greater.
Maybe just before leaving, I'd like to show a comment precisely to that notion of rights, and say, what are the rights of human rights. And I think that right now the whole notion and the foundation of rights is being undermined by the necessity to introduce into what is a subject, a right-bearing subject, entities that are non-human or non-human rights. In particular, in the courts of Ecuador and Bolivia, where we work, ecosystems have got the status of legal subject. It's a very interesting not only that particular tree, but a certain kind of relation between species and a particular space-time whose borders are not fully defined have rights.
Can I ask you before you go on, who was the architect of that legislation?
That was in effect the political move in Bolivia and Ecuador that saw indigenous communities take control of the parliament, that saw left-wing government allow the introduction of animistic conception into the frame of expanded non-human rights. So it came from the kind of the intersection of those two. Now, we're working in Indonesia, and I'd love to speak to you about that. In fact, I'm flying from here, right, through Rome to Indonesia, to take a project about the human rights of the orangutans. Now, what is interesting about the orangutans is that for 200 years, only for 200 years, they haven't been human, right? So, till the 18th century, till the end of the 18th century, the orangutan apes of Borneo and Sumatra were considered part of the indigenous population of this island. It was only then that, under the lens of science, a line has been drawn between the orangutan and humans. And guess what happened?
So the orangutans were essentially
humans.
Odd humans.
Yeah, I mean, I think for the European colonizers, many of the indigenous people of Borneo were kind of odd. You know, it was.
There are cases of mating.
One thing I want to end with is to say, guess what happened 2 years after the orangutan was excluded from the human species? The Declaration of Rights of Man and Citizen was actually written up in the French, in the context of the French Revolution. The notion of right and of human rights is to do with a sharp border, a very violent border that has been drawn between human and nature. As that border is now eroded, or eroding, or if we want to erode it ourselves, join me in eroding that. We need to basically start speaking about rights outside the human, the frame of the human, if we are to make it a progressive force in the world again. So I have to catch up on Pareto. You're right. Is that okay? Could I go?
You can go. You know, thank you very, very much. I'll be in touch. Wonderful. Thank you for coming. We'll just window this down one by one. I'll tell you.
Histories look the way they do. But what I found really amazing about this particular conference is that it seems to me that architects really do maintain a kind of hopefulness about what can be built and what the future can hold that a lot of critical geographers have lost. And so, and we need to get that back from you, I think, because there has to be some, as you were saying in your initial comments, there has to be some kind of hopefulness that drives the steps that people take.
One of my favorite quotations I saw in the German Pavilion, and it says, as you talked about the legal situation, and the first step would, or should be the legalization of situation. In the German Pavilion, you can read, in the German Pavilion, you notice it, we can read, tolerating semi-legal practices can make sense. So this you can read in the very German Pavilion. So, well, I think all these situations, these movements we are facing now, and the same was back in history, they all don't care about legal situations. On the contrary, what we saw in Europe last summer, the refugees did not care about the legal situations, and even the European governments did not care about the legal frameworks. Otherwise, a real catastrophe would have taken place. So, I used to be a lawyer. I have to admit that. But, law is very much, in my perception, a kind of social science, and you have to see that the legal framework never is going beyond the existing situation. It only can try to regulate for the future what you see now. And you mentioned it, what we will have in terms of changing the climate and also changing political situations in the future in terms of the age of geography. It will be much more than now an age of migration, an age of changing society. So if the only half or only if a third of the African continent inhabitants will go on the move to the rich states in Europe, in the US or even in Asia, this will be a totally different situation, and you cannot regulate it or stream it through legal regulations, and even not by kind of buildings. One of the most impressive examples was given us by the Romans. You all know the so-called limes, a gigantic wall in the northern frontier of the Roman Imperium, thousands of kilometers long, with not just little fences, but really massive walls. And with this, they tried to control migrations and situations with the so-called barbarians. And what happened? Nevertheless, or maybe even exactly because they relied on the power of this fortifying system, the Roman Imperium collapsed. So it's not about relying on formal regulations or fortifying situations. What we have to start finally is to change our minds and to prepare in our minds and in our philosophical, social, and economic situations, what will happen in 20, 30, 50 years. And there will happen a lot. And if we only rely on fences and on legal things, this rich Europe and also other rich countries will collapse like the Roman period.
They talk a lot about walls these days, but the most profound statement, I mean, it's very simple, but it struck me very, very deeply, was after the events in Paris in November and Belgium, as the French were saying, and it was so true, is il n'y a plus de frontières, there are simply no longer any borders. The war, in Syria and extended elsewhere was actually potentially now happening everywhere. There was no real territorial specificity, that the thing had become almost a spore or a virus that could pop up anywhere. In a way, it could spread like an epidemic, it could lay dormant, it could rise up, etc. It's a fascinating transformation in our historical psyche. The responsibility has not yet followed, and it strikes me as the crisis that we talked about only 7 or 8 months ago is just laying now in a state of dormancy because nobody really absorbed those immigrants, really. America has taken barely 10,000, I think, so far. Almost no country has even begun to honor their commitments. And waves and waves are preparing to still. I wonder if, as a last question, even to the audience, one can imagine what it's going to be like to be an architect if some of our speculations, in a way, hold true, even if half of them hold true. What would it be like? What will an architect be doing and thinking in 10 years, different from what they, in a way, were allowed to do 10 years ago? Any thoughts? Can anyone imagine the implications?
That's a quick for me. I'm wondering, this is also a question, a follow-up corollary maybe, is when I think about what I see in camps and what I see in research, and Rachel, you mentioned scale, how do we think about building? How do we think about buildings? And in the case of camps, I mean, I really see it as a tension between detail and territory, and the building somewhere in between. Sometimes it's an afterthought, sometimes it's trying to build a better shelter, but there's always that tension between detail, even how we maybe anchor something in the ground, and territory, whether it's broader systems of migration or systems of capital.
So you see architects can still think about how things connect, the detail, how you connect massively disparate scales. Fascinating to think about an architect working on details.
That's true. Yeah. What does that look like, guys? Mike?
Can I ask a question for you, Chuck? I mean, I watched your book when it came out, and I never read it, so since Chair Robust addressed the question of what architects do, as opposed to what engineers do that are being called in if there is a catastrophe. Yeah, and they have the solutions and architecture usually do something different. Yeah, and since he mentioned the show of the Antarctic Pavilion, the teaching studio, we were also asking ourselves some questions. So there is Antarctica, this is maybe a territory that has not been of use until now, but with this kind of the largest freshwater reserves and the changing climate, maybe it will become something that is attractive. But you just have to elicit what the qualities might be that are there. In the entrance, we put up a big globe that says, and I think that belongs to countries. is also that this is a virgin territory. This is just a fantasy that there was massive interest there, but we thought that it might be a country for the migrants. Yeah, like, you know, there is the plan for the next Olympics to have one nationality that is for migrants. And they will have their own team. But the question specifically to you would be, is camp always a derogatory term? As opposed to architecture, is camp architecture? Or is camp something that is, today we heard that it's something that might come up for the necessity and control these were the two terms that I have in my memory. And architecture is also something that, and this is what you see in this show, is spectacle in a positive sense. I mean spectacle not as the Gogh would have it, as do the spectacle and just put sand into people's eyes and not see what the real conditions or what the real terms of society are. But the spectacle is something that celebrates the new opportunity. And I think this is what was criticizing, that the solutions that we have is like, a kind of space where nobody wants to go.
I think just thinking about the exhibit, I thought it was interesting how sort of almost like icebergs, right? Each five or seven speculations are sort of laid out as these sort of constructed situations, right, or possibilities. And I guess that's how I see camps, the possibility of a constructed situation, and that prospectively what it might be. I don't think camps are cities. I mean, I think they maybe have some of the genes of cities. They have some of the, hopefully they have infrastructure, they have other things. But I think they're, in a way, much more interesting in their infancy and possibility of what a city or what installation is. So I guess I'm hoping to understand camps both as problem and possibility, or problematic, right? Identifying the problem, but also possibility. So in that way, and I think, Gerald, you touched on this yesterday, the idea of setting a problem, I mean, certainly hopefully solving or getting towards a solution of a problem, but actually setting that problem, I think, is what's really interesting. Finding the problem and then setting it. Like, it's a little bit
me
is a banal thing to say, but I can't help it. What artists have done for a long time, it's not just real estate the problem. The problem is cultural patterns of cultural settlement and spontaneous organization. Serious relation with one another, they will reproduce many of their cultural forms, many of their practices. They will take place in a certain kind of density and proximity with one another. It will create an effective interface with the outside. It will provide certain types of protections for preservation of cultural forms, but also some, say, legal type activities, possibly even develop. You know, we know all kind of things that come to cities are, you know, so this is the question, let's say, that modernist architecture has very clearly failed to fully address and understand in its urban propositions, even in the great tradition of social housing. The question is, how can the architect bring a unique endowment in life to this problem, which is really, we can't even define what it is. Cultural, historical, you know, ethical, economic, probably even thermodynamic, et cetera, et cetera. So the question, of course, is where the architect's specific traditions of thinking, where can it bring that kind of leverage to bear on the problem? That's to say, how can you bring the imagination to the problem? Like, I don't have an answer. Sure, I have it. But if the architect would just acknowledge that was a severe problem, it would be wonderful.
Really thinking
of
the age of geography is great.
Well, you would say so.
In a very embodied way.
You know, I believe it, even if I can't defend it. Wow. It feels right. Sure. And I'm glad you guys came in order to make me look like it was. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming. Thank you.